सेम, या आई एम रिकॉर्डिंग द सेम.
ओके
थैंक यू लेजिन. ओ या, सो बेसिकली वी आस्क अस फॉर मल्टीपल थिंग्स लाइक व्हाट इज द इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर दे आर लुकिंग फॉर वेयर दे विल बी रनिंग द एप्लीकेशन, व्हाट इज द बेस ऑफ द एप्लीकेशन, whether it will be developed on which runtime, runtime means whether they will be using .NET core, they will be using ASP.NET or Java, PHP, Python, multiple things will be asked, right? So earlier what was happening is client was giving all that information at a very starting phase. At a very starting phase, they were giving all that information. All the information is collected, analysis is done. Then we basically used to design a solution that, okay, this is a solution that fits to the client needs, what client is actually looking for. So guys, today we'll be starting with bit of theoretical session to basically come on to a same page that why exactly we need DevOps, and slowly and gradually we'll try to do more and more labs, right? So why exactly, what kind of a solution can be built for the client? So we design a solution, then that particular solution will be passed on to the development team or to the application team. They will try to write the codes on that particular design. After writing the codes, they will try to test the codes, whether the code that they have written in the correct manner or not. Then it will be going to the testing mode. Then it will be going basically to the production team. So there are different teams who are working behind that particular solution. It's not like one single team will be working behind that particular solution. The product development will be going from to multiple phases, right? And earlier, the method that we used to follow, one by one team will work on the same. It's not like all the teams will be working on the same. One by one teams will be working on the same. So that is what we used to call as a waterfall method. There is something called as a waterfall method. So one by one team will start in working on the same. So first we will try to collect as much information as we can collect from the client who is looking for a particular product. If I give you in very layman terms, let's say Zomato is trying to develop an application. So we'll ask the Zomato client, okay, what kind of an application you are trying to build? What exactly your application would be doing? What all do you want to integrate with your application? What all features you are looking inside your application? And guys, would request you, anyone who do not have a query, please put you on mute. Yeah, so what exactly you are looking for from that particular application? So we'll be asking all that part. We'll try to collect all that information, right? And once the information is collected, then we will do the analysis that what all is required. So first is system and software requirements will be taken care by the client. We will first try to collect all the information regarding the, so if I say here, once we'll be collecting all the system and software information or software requirement information from the client, that what exactly the system and software requirements are, right? After collecting all that information, then we will be doing the analysis for that particular one. So we'll do the analysis that what is feasible, what is not feasible, if feasible, how it can be achieved, if not feasible, what needs to be changed in order to make it achievable. So we'll be doing the analysis of, so here analytics team will be working here. So here there will be analytics team who will be working here. After the job of the analytics teams is done, then it will be going to the design team. Then design team will be designing a solution for the same. Once the design of the product is created, once the designing is done, then the development team will start working on the same. Then the development team will start writing the code based upon the design that has been approved. So that design has to be approved as well. Analytics will be done, analysis is approved, design will be done, maybe changes will be done into the design. Design is done, design will be approved. Then we will be going to the development team. Then development teams, based upon the design that has been approved, they will start writing the code for the same. They will start creating the code for the same. And once the development team says, okay, we have done the development, we have done the development from our end, they will hand it over to the testing team. Testing team will try to test the product. They will try to test if there is any security glitch or if there is any glitch with the product. They will try to do. There are multiple tools with which testing can be done as well. Right? So right now we are talking in very layman terms. So a lot of testing can be done. And once testing team says, okay, it looks like the product is good. We are good in order to deploy the product into the production. Then they will basically hand over the product to the deployment and operations maintenance for the same, right? Now, the problem here is, this is what we can call as a waterfall method. This is what we can call as a, what was called as a waterfall method, right? Now, waterfall method or waterfall model, whatever you would like to refer. So this is a waterfall model that we were following. Now here, we took the requirement from the client. We took the requirement, we did the analysis, designing, development, test, deployment, right? Now this particular phase will take good amount of time. It's not like today we took the requirement and tomorrow or day after tomorrow or in next week the design will be ready, then development is done, then testing is done. So this entire process, it can take good amount of months or it can take years as well. So usually the period is in between couple of months to 1 to 2 years. So this entire process will take some time, right? After the everything is done, so in the meantime, while the process is going on, mostly we were not interacting with the clients. Mostly we were not showing that what kind of a product we have built so far. So if design is done, okay, we will not be interacting with the client much. The client for whom we are creating this particular software or the product, we are not interacting with the client much, right? As a result of that, what challenges we used to face is, after an year or two, once the product is built, once it is done, testing is done, deployment is done, once we will showcase a product to the client says, this is not what I'm looking for. In most of the scenarios, or in many cases we saw, the client says, this is what not we are looking for. In some cases, even we came to a point that when client gave us a requirement, what kind of a system and software requirement, when client gave us a requirement, because everything will be documented, it's not like client just said and we started working on the same. So when the system and the software requirement which client gave us, maybe even client was not aware of the what exactly the product he is looking for. So even they did not provide it as a precise information, the product they are looking for. And at the end, it was nothing but a miss. So client is unable to use the product, the client experience has been hampered, there were a lot of challenges. So what we said, maybe we would be able to, instead of waterfall method, maybe we should design a different method by which we would be able to overcome these challenges, right? So here, the teams are not working together. Design team will only be working on the design part. Once design is approved, they will hand it over to the development. Now, if there is any issue with the development, design team is not at all responsible. They will not go ahead and make the changes. Once one part of the design is done, it's handed over to development, design team is not going to do anything, right? So basically, the teams are not interacting well. In a layman terms, if I say, the teams are not interacting in a very well manner. And as a result of that, our end user, or as a result of that, the client, yes, any questions? And as a result of that, the client. Sir, your voice is breaking.
Hello?
Yes, I can hear you now.
May I ask a question?
Yeah, please go ahead.
As far as the cloud computing is concerned, we have Google, we have Azure. We have these type of online cloud computing where we can save the data. But do ever we have think about in security of the data, how we can secure the data? Because today, right now, it's a 21st generation and hackers are right now, especially from China, is hacking money, confidential data, which is saved on cloud database. Suppose if Google have saved its data on cloud, if Azure, Microsoft have saved its data on cloud, so it can be hacked by those persons. So how we can save that data from those things?
Okay, so for that, there are different security methods we have in cloud. So in Azure, we have multiple security methods which we can make use of. There are multiple levels by which we would be able to secure things. That is something which we called as defense in depth. So we can do the security at a physical level, at a perimeter level, at a network level, at an application level, at an identity level. So multiple layers of security we can put, and we would be able to save our identities, not only data, we would be able to save our identities, we would be able to save our data, we would be able to save our machines. So we have something called as firewall, network security group, application security group, DDoS, bastion host, policies, multiple things are there. We can make use of identity protection, we can make use of multi-factor authentication, we can make use of conditional access. So multiple things are there by which we would be able to secure it. So in this particular course, sir, we are not talking about the security of the data. Definitely we'll come to that point as well at a certain stage. But right now the course talks about the application development. While we are creating an application, if in case we are storing the application code, where are we going to store it? How we will push the application code into our web apps, or maybe into our logic apps, or maybe into any other apps. So this course curriculum or this course content is entirely different. So if in case you are looking for a better solutions on security, I think there is one course that is what we call as AZ500, which talks about specifically for the Azure security. So
I'm talking about, we have FBI, we have RAW, we have government agencies. So when they store data, they may store on hard drives. Probably they may store on cloud, like Azure or Google. But what about those things? It's a concern of the international security. Because hackers, when they go over there, they don't have these things in concern in mind. They break every walls. Like if it is firewall, in was like firewall has hackers the cloud. And being modern endeavors have.
Sir, in that case, what we can do, we can go for the hybrid solution. So in that case, what we can do, we can go for a hybrid solution. Maybe we can just host the application in cloud, and the data we can store inside our on-premise, inside our data centers. So maybe if in case data is a very concern for us, maybe just like banking organizations, data is really crucial. So what they will do, they will simply put the data. Sir, I'm unable to hear you. Sir, I'm not able to hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, it's better now.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, it's better. Actually,
can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Yeah. Sir, I have I had a project on how to protect the data. Okay. The project was data stenography, data hiding behind images. Okay, sir?
Mm-hmm.
So whenever we try to write the data, suppose I have attributes. I have attributes of a person, his name, email ID, his address, his employee ID, his identity, his all those things, his designation, whatever soever. And I have these 10,000, 12,000, 30,000, 1 million persons on their attributes. So I'm saving them and I'm making a SQL database. So once I save them, I encrypt those things into the pictures and I send through the wireless mode, like Bluetooth or something else, and put it into the cloud. So whenever somebody tried, suppose a data
sir,
is hiding behind the image, like if a hacker tries to...
Sajid, I'm so sorry to interrupt you. But sir, we are not discussing data course here. Like we are not talking about data course and we are not discussing any particular scenario. Maybe you are working on a particular project. So we are not discussing that project. I'm so sorry to interrupt you. Like I really don't want to interrupt you, but this is not, we are talking about the data course. So I would really request you guys, if you can please restrict your queries to the course that we are discussing, right? Because maybe sir, different people might be working on a different project. I really don't want to interrupt you, but different people might be working on different.
This question was related to the cloud computing, because everything, the thing which right now in 21st century is being stored on the clouds, like
Azure is doing, Amazon is doing, Flipkart is doing, all those companies are like right now, Google have its drive, they sell the drives like 3000, they give 1 terabyte. So it's like that.
So basically, sorry to interrupt Ganesh here. So basically you can use the KMS keys for every data. So apart from your security group, NACLs and all the stuff, so everywhere you can encrypt and use the KMS keys kind of thing. So that is secure. Because a lot of companies in US, they are in a cloud and they are using this kind of keys. So no one access actually. As of now, no one
can. Actually, there is a problem. There is a problem. In India, we use non-pirated softwares. Like, we don't purchase the applicable softwares for the computer system. And if we talk about the USA, they purchase the licensed softwares, which are licensed, which have protection, and they renew those softwares. This is the problem. We have Chinese apps. We install those things, whatever we have China system and type of apps. And we have many pirated things, which can easily be hacked by those hackers. So the China is right now selling money softwares.
Yeah,
so they have automatically built a logic around this. That
yeah, Jamal sir, what I was trying to say is,
Jatin, this is a Pramod here, Jatin. So I think we are going to different directions. So this
absolutely.
We can talk about this. If you talk about the security feature, this is the one company decision whether how to secure the data. Okay. But the things is here we are talking about the totally different, right?
Yeah, absolutely. That is what I tried to tell to the gentleman. So, sir, we can have a discussion on to the security. Right. So, guys, let me just cover what I have to cover on this session. Then probably whosoever has a questions regarding to security or any other cloud computing mechanism, we can discuss this once the session will end. We can definitely take your queries and we can talk about that. And just to end it, as a gentleman said, we can make use of KMS keys or we can make use of certificates in order to secure the data. There are multiple means of securing the data. So we just need to use the right approach and we can secure the data to a next level. All right, so thank you guys. So let's come back to the same part which we were discussing earlier regarding the application lifecycle or development. So we were discussing regarding, we started with the system and software requirement. We did the analysis, design, development, test, and deployment. So basically what I was trying to say is the teams were not interacting well with each other. If design part is done, now application is into the development phase, the design team will not give any value to it if in case again the design needs to be changed. So they are not going to change the design. Once it's approved, the design is okay, it has moved to the development phase, design team says, my work is over. Before I handed it over to the development team, I have got the approval. So now I'm not going to change anything into the design, right? As a result of that, what was happening? As a result of that, the end user experience was on a toss. So we were unable to, in order to improve the end user experience, we came to the agile methodology. So in agile methodology, what we were doing, basically we were trying to create a transformation team. Basically, we were trying to create a team so that while we are deploying the application code or while we are designing anything, we are trying to shorten the cycle. So we can go to the agile methods. Or agile model, you can say, whatever you would like to refer. So basically what we are trying to do is we are trying to shorten the cycle. Which cycle we are trying to shorten? Whenever we are, let's say there is a feature that we are developing for a tool, there is a feature that we are developing for a product. So a code will be written for that particular feature. Once the code is written, it's tested, we will try to showcase it to the client that this is a feature we have developed. Do you feel that there is any changes needs to be done into this particular one? It says, yes, maybe this thing needs to be added or this thing needs to be subtracted. Or maybe the client says, it looks as what I'm expecting. So what we are trying to do, we are trying to bring a method with the help of which we can do continuous integration and continuous delivery. So we are trying to achieve CI/CD basically, continuous integration, continuous delivery, or you can say continuous integration and continuous deployment. Basically, we are trying to create a loop. First, we will plan things, we will build things, right? we will integrate those things, we will operate on those things, we will get a feedback regarding the same, right? And again, we will plan things. So what we are trying to do, we are trying to create a loop mechanism. We will plan, we will create a plan, we will build things as per our plan, we will be writing the application code, developers would be, or development team would be writing the application code, they will build the application, then we will integrate the application with the production where the application actually needs to run. After we have integrated the application into the production, then we will operate on that particular application. So once we operate on that particular application, then we will try to collect the feedback continuously. We will try to create a mechanism with the help of which we can create the continuous feedback, right? I'm sure in many applications you have seen that they have given a feature for the feedback, that you can give feedback. Whatever feedback you will give, that will be received by a particular team. Now they will try to collaborate all the feedbacks that they have received over a given period of time. They will try to make changes into the code. Development team will try to make changes as per the feedback we have received into the code. After making the changes, again, we will build the application with the changes now. And again, we will integrate it. And again, we will operate on the new code. That is the reason I'm sure you would have seen. Whenever you are using any particular application, you will see some kind of a version updates. The new version has came. So what we are trying to do, we are trying to continuously enhance the user experience. So basically it says DevOps is nothing. It is a union of people, process, and products to enable continuous delivery so that we would be able to give more value to our end users. The word dev and ops means development and operations we are trying to bring together. Earlier, we were doing the development and then we were doing the operations. So those teams were working individually, separately. There was no coordination in between. We are trying to create a well-mannered coordination, or maybe we are trying to create such a team. On that particular team, maybe we can bring people from different teams and then we can create one single team. Maybe we can call it as a multidisciplinary team. So we are trying to create a multidisciplinary team that now works together with the shared and the efficient practices and tools. So everyone would be able to share their experience, what they have seen during their career so far. And as a result of that, we would be able to bring a better product for the client. So when all the teams will be working together, now let's say a design team has created a design. We will try to write a code. We will try to present the code to the testing team. Or we will try to present the code to the client for whom we are building this code. The client, we can ask the client, okay, is this code looks good? He says no. If in case he says no, or if in case he says a particular changes are required, we will again go back to the design team that as per the feedback that we have received from the client, we need to make these changes into the design. Now design team then and there would be able to make those changes. Based upon the changes that the design team has done, we would be again able to write a code. So now we don't have to wait for the entire life cycle. What we are trying to do, we are trying to shorten the life cycle so that effectively we would be able to build a process. Effectively, we would be able to build a product. Many people feel that DevOps is a technology. Guys, DevOps is not a technology. It is a transformation that we are trying to look. It is a method that we are trying to implement so that we can achieve better user experience. We can achieve better performance, better product we would be able to build for the client. If I say in very layman terms, right? So it is a continuous journey. Then what we can make use of? We can make use of data informed. There are data informed things which we would be able to make use of. Data informed means whatever data we have, whatever data we have, which we have received from the previous cycles. So let's say we design a product, we developed a code, we presented the code to the client, client gave us a feedback. So what we are doing, we are collecting all this data. Now, when we will be going into the next cycle, into for the same part, again, while we will be designing it, while we would be developing it, we can make use of the data that we already have as of now, right? So we can make use of the data informed. Data informed part we would be able to make use of. So as per the surveys that have been done, so what they have found in the surveys is one third of the ideas or one third of the product that we will try to bring or that we will try to push, one third of the ideas, they have a negative impact, right? One third of the ideas, they have a positive impact, and one third of the idea does not make any difference into the product. So what we are trying to achieve, we are trying to eliminate those one third part that is making a negative impact, so that we would be able to find out that these method or is not good. Maybe we don't want to bring it into this product development. The ones which are giving us a positive results, maybe we would be able to focus more towards the same. So with DevOps journey, what we are trying to achieve, we are trying to achieve the continuous integration drives. We are trying to merge the development, the testing, the design part all together, so that we would be able to find the defects early as possible. And instead of later on fighting with the issues, like because of which the product has finally failed, it failed because of the design team, or it failed because of the analysis team was unable to do the analysis appropriately, or design team was unable to design the product appropriately. Instead of fighting on all those issues, probably we would be able to create such a team which would be able to build a better product. In waterfall method, if the product has been done, we are not making changes at a later stage. So if product has reached a later stage where product is about to be built, and then if client comes back and says, okay, I would like to change the design, then we are not going to change the design. But in agile method, even if in case a client comes up at a very later stage and they say that I would like to change the design, then we are okay to change the design. So basically, our purpose is not to just build a product. Our purpose is to build a better product for a client, so that we can achieve the client satisfaction. We can achieve a better we can give better user experience to the client. So that is what we are trying to achieve with the help of agile model. That is the agile method that we are trying to achieve. We are trying to
ask a question.
Please, sir, please go ahead.
Ask a question, sir.
Yes, yes.
Number one question is, how can we understand the contents of the client?
Jamal, sir, your voice is breaking. I am unable to hear you. I think because of internet connection, I think I'm unable to hear you properly. So your voice is coming in a robotic manner.
Yeah, sir. I'm from
Jammu and Kashmir. Actually, we have 2G internet connection over here. Oh. That's the problem.
Okay. Yes. Now it's clear. Please go ahead, sir.
I hope you understand.
Now my question is, we have a client, okay? A client is uneducated. He doesn't know about the softwares. So he's planning to make a website. He's planning to make a good thing for his company. So he's an asset for us. So once we, as per the business module is concerned, so we need to spoke him like he gonna provide us the finance budget, how he wants to make his website, like for any programming language, like whether he go for the Java, PHP, .NET, Python, or C#, C++, HTML, whatever. So it is up to us how we can build the client's website. So there are certain few questions, like if we develop the client's website, we have to look about the contents of the website, like how we gonna do the contents. Like number first step, there should be.
Sir, are you there?
I think we lost his computer.
We lost a gentleman here for some reason. Let's go ahead, guys. I think he'll join back probably in some time. So then we can again take his question. So what we are trying to say is, we are trying to do the DevOps journey. We are trying to do the continuous integration. Then we have something called as continuous deployment. So basically, with the help of continuous deployment, we are trying to achieve the continuous deployment of software solutions into the production and into the testing environments, which will basically help the organization achieve in order to resolve their issues quickly. We would be able to resolve the bugs quickly. We would be able to resolve the business changing requirements quickly. So maybe when client gave us a project, maybe they have a different requirement. while we are working with the project, maybe they change their project. Maybe the business is changing so rapidly, the business is evolving so rapidly. Maybe the client now would like to go in a different direction altogether. So we would be able to cater all those requests. Then there is something called as version control. It's a very important concept, version control. Whenever we are creating any product or whenever we are creating any software, there is something called as version control. What is version control? There are different levels of version control, different types, I should say, of version control. There is something called as Git, right? Guys, there is a difference between Git and GitHub. We will talk about those differences in detail. There is a lot of difference between Git and GitHub. So there is a version control called Git, and there is something called as TFVC, right? So there is something called as TFVC. These are different kind of a version control mechanism, or we can say these are different kind of a SCM. These are different kind of a source control management. What is source control? If in case we are writing an application code, obviously the code will be saved somewhere. The application code the developers are writing, the code will be stored somewhere. Where I'm storing the code? There are two kind of an SCM. One is what we called as distributed, and one is what we called as centralized. There are two kinds of an SCM. One is what we called as distributed, and one is what we called as SCM. The Git is the distributed one. The Git is the distributed SCM, and TFVC is the centralized one. Now, what does centralized and distributed means? Centralized means all the codes, basically there will be a repository. The code that we have written, there will be a repository for the same, right? Repository is where we are storing all the code. So if it's centralized, it means all the codes have been, whatever application code we have written, it is stored at a one given place, that is centralized. Distributed means maybe application code is lying on multiple places. I am following a distributed approach. Now, what is Git? What is TFVC? What is the difference? Exactly everything. How they actually works in the background. How we can store the code in Git, how we can store the code in TFVC. We will talk about that. Right now, I'm just giving you some words. I'm just giving you some, I should say, technical jargons, that these are some things which works in the background. So what is repository? Repository is nothing but a place where we are storing all the application code. I'm sure all of you can connect that if in case we are building an application, definitely we will be writing the application code. If we are writing the application code, we would be saving that application code somewhere. Now, repository is something where we have stored the application code. I am saying repository can be of two types. It can be a distributed sort of a repository, or it can be a centralized sort of a repository. Distributed sort of a repository means the code, the same code might be stored at multiple locations. The same code, maybe some part of the code is stored somewhere, some part of the code is stored somewhere, some part of the code is stored somewhere. That can be the distributed approach. Centralized approach means code will be stored only at a given place. Whenever I have to make the changes, I have to make the changes on that particular place. That is a distributed kind of an, that is a centralized kind of an approach. So if I am following distributed sort of an approach, I am following Git. With the help of Git, I can follow the distributed kind of an repository approach. With the form of a centralized, there is something called as TFVC. TFVC was used earlier. Nowadays, most of the clients who are going for the version control, this is what we call as version control, SCM, source control management, you can say. So most of the clients who are now going for the version control, they are following the Git methodology. Earlier, mostly we were following the TFVC methodology. So now you will see many clients who are working, who have stored their code earlier, they are using the TFVC approach. And many clients who are moving towards now, they are following the Git approach. So TFVC stands for Team Foundation Version Control. What is the full form of TFVC? TFVC stands for Team Foundation Version Control. That is the full form. So this is, someone asks you, what is TFVC? Sometimes people may ask. So this is the team foundation version control. It's a centralized approach, and Git is the is a distributed approach for the version control. So guys, I hope you have a basic idea now. Like, what is version control? Version control means how we are controlling the repository that we have, where the application code is lying. So we can have a distributed approach. We can have a centralized approach. SCM is how we are managing the code, how we are managing the repository. That is the SCM, right? So it says version control basically uses Git, enables team located anywhere in the world. If my team is located anywhere across the globe, we can communicate effectively during daily development activities. So let's say one person is located maybe in US, one in Europe, one in India. And if I have to share what changes I have done together. So maybe I can store the code locally, the entire code, all three of us are stored locally. Maybe I only want to share what changes I have done only with a UK person. I don't want to share it with a US person. I can do that. Whatever changes I have done into the code, right? When we are developing an application code, it's not like one developer would be writing everything. There are a lot of developers. A lot of developers would be working from their machines, right? They would be either using, let's say, Visual Studio, or maybe they would be using Visual Studio Code. These are some IDCs which they can make use of, right? They would be using these tools. There are some other tools as well. There are a lot of tools as well. So they will be using some kind of a tools. These are called as IDE. So that they would be using from their machines. So when they log in into their machines, they will log in into their tool. And from there, they will try to write the code. They will first create a project. In that project, they will try to put the code, right? So they will be making use of that. So these are the tools from where they will be working. There can be a lot of tools. I'm just giving you a very basic information. So how they will be developing is they will be making use of their own tools, right? And these tools can be referred as IDE. For example, Visual Studio, Visual Studio Code. They can be referred as IDE. What is IDE? IDE is Integrated Development Environment. It is full form is Integrated Development Environment. Developers would be using these development tools in order to write the application code. I'm just giving you a basic information so that we all can come onto a same page, because from tomorrow onwards, if I try to say, okay, now we are going to use Git in order to store our code into the IDE, so that we all can be on the same page that what is IDE, what is Git, whether we are using distributed approach or whether we are going to use centralized approach. I'm just trying to familiarize all of you with some mechanisms or some technical things which we will be using in this particular course. So that tomorrow when I say, okay, now we are going to use Git, we will be cloning the code into the Git, and now we are going to make use of some IDE, maybe VS Code, so that we would be able to make some changes into the code, right? So that all of you would be able to find out, okay, now what exactly we are going to do. So I'm just trying to familiarize all of you with these terms. I'm sure most of you would have an idea regarding these, but anyone who do not have an idea, so that we all can come onto the same page, right? So then we discuss that we can make use of agile planning and lean project management techniques. Agile planning means we can do the changes, we can shorten the life cycle. We can try to implement the code as much as possible. We can try to collect the feedback. Whatever changes needs to be done, it needs to be done with the analysis team, it needs to be done with the design team, or it needs to be done from the development team. We would be able to make all those changes. Then with the benefit, now we have got many benefits from the public and the hybrid cloud. Now earlier when we used to have our data center, there were restrictions on our data center. Maybe in my data center, I can only create 500 virtual machines. In cloud, there is no such restriction. Cloud gives us complete scalability and complete elasticity. When I say complete scalability and complete elasticity means scalability and complete elasticity. I am trying to say, now let's say I created a VM. The VM is of 4 CPU and 16 GB RAM. 16 GB RAM. Now cloud give me complete scalability. Scalability means now if I would like to give more resources to this particular VM, maybe I would like to make it as 8 CPU and 64 GB machine, or maybe I would like to make it as 32 CPU and 256 GB of machine. Maybe I have to test something which is very, I need a very high-end machine, or maybe I need a machine which is 256 CPU and maybe let's say 1024 GB of RAM. So it can give me a huge capacity. Whatever capacity we are looking for, it can give us that capacity. Earlier, what was happening, guys, just sharing a story, FYI. There were organizations which were running the SAP database, right? So when they were holding the SAP database, the size was not appropriate for those organizations. So they approached Microsoft, that we need a bigger machine, which can provide us more CPU and more RAM. So Microsoft developed an VM and they named it as, I think they named it as Godzilla, right? So with this particular machine, what they were getting, I think around 1000 GB of RAM or something, or around 1 TB of RAM or something they were able to give. Yeah, I think 1 TB of RAM they were able to allocate. So huge capacity they were able to allocate. Again, I think the team came, that still that is not enough. Still that is not enough for us. So I think then they developed a machine, they named it as Beast. So these are special machines which are designed for special organizations. So what I'm trying to say is, if in case we have such a special requirement, we can reach Microsoft, they would be able to give us these dedicated machines. If in case maybe I have an application which I have to test, or maybe I have a huge database that I have to test and I need a very, very high-end machine, that we can get the complete scalability from Microsoft end. Whatever the amount of machine resources I want to allocate to my machines I'm looking for, we can get that. There is something called as Beast, and there is something called as Beast 2.0, right? So very, very high-end machines, which a normal user cannot even think of. Right. Obviously, the pricing would be very, very high. But yes, as far as scalability is concerned, we can get the complete scalability using the public clouds. Maybe if in case we are concerned, we don't want to host the data into the cloud, maybe we just want to use the compute capabilities from cloud, we can do that. For compute capabilities, we can go with cloud. In order to store our database, maybe we can go to on-premise. So what we can do, we can make use of hybrid cloud scenarios. We can make use of hybrid clouds. I can use a public cloud like Azure or AWS or Google, or I can make use of my on-premise as well. That is, I can build a hybrid scenario. So even that is possible with the help of this. Right. Then we have got something called as infrastructure as a code. So earlier what we were doing, now what we normally do, we go to our, so let me show you the Azure portal. So let's say if I have to create the virtual machine, what will I do? I'll go to my Azure portal. This is my Azure portal. Maybe I can click on the virtual machine, right? I'll click on the virtual machine like this. And maybe I'll try to create a virtual machine. So what I'm doing, I'm making use of GUI. Now let's say if I have to create 20 virtual machines, I have to do the same activity probably 20 times, right? And let's say if I have to build 20 machines and I have to build 2 networks, I have to build 3 storage accounts. I have to build a load balancer. I have to do this activity numerous times. Microsoft says, no need to worry about that. What you can make use of? You can make use of the ARM templates. There is something called as ARM templates. ARM stands for Azure Resource Manager. So anyone who has worked on Azure, probably they will have a good idea regarding the same. That is something called as Azure Resource Manager templates. So we can use these templates, and then these templates, with the help of these templates, we can create our resources. That is something which we also refer as IAC. That is what we called as infrastructure as a code. We can write as infrastructure as a code. So I don't have to go to GUI in order to deploy my resources every now and then. I can create it like this in this format. So this is created in the JSON format. This is created in the JSON format. Let me show you one ARM template. So if I go to my C drive, I might have some ARM templates here. So let me just go to my C drive. So if I just scroll it down, these are some templates that I have got. For example, let's say I click on this particular one. So this is some kind of a template that I have got. This is written in the JSON format. So if you see, this is how the ARM templates look like. I can just make use of this template and I would be able to deploy some resources. I don't need to go to GUI. And if I make use of this template, what all I'm going to get, I would be able to deploy a storage account. I would be able to deploy a VM and I would be able to deploy a web application together. I don't have to go three times in Azure in order to create one resource. I'll simply deploy this template and I would be able to deploy all three resources in a single go. That is how we can make use of infrastructure as a code. So how we will be using infrastructure as a code will be coming up into the upcoming sessions. We'll be using these kind of the codes and we will be deploying resources with the help of this. So today I'm just giving you a glimpse what all we can do it in, or what all we can do it with the help of DevOps services. Then basically what we need to do is maybe we can create a different, I would say we can create a separate transformation teams. We can create some transformation teams, right? We can choose the availability of the staff members who are leading the transformation project earlier. Any member who has a good reputation in the organization, any member who knows how things or how approval gets done within the organization. So maybe we can choose those team members. We can choose those team members who are ready to change things, who really feel that some change is required in order to enhance the organization or in order to enhance the product. Some changes are required. Maybe we can choose those team members. We can also create a team in a versatile manner. So when I say versatile manner means we should be choosing the team members from different corners who are trained on different technologies, right? Who are trained on different technologies. So we can do that. We would be able to do this part as well. So that is what we can do. I think, guys, we have done a lot of theoretical discussion. It might sound boring now. So before it, we go to a state where it completely becomes entirely boring. Let me show you some something onto the portal as well. We can again come back to this. Some part is still left from the theoretical parts. Let's come back to here. Now, I think most of you would like to know how can we start something with Azure, right? So anyone who would like to start something with Azure, first of all, we need to have an Azure account. Anyone who is already using Azure, they would be able to connect easily. First thing, we need an Azure account. What is an Azure account? Let's say if I want to send an email using the Gmail account, I need a Gmail email address, need a Gmail account. Similarly, if I would like to start my journey with Azure, I need an Azure account. Let's say my account is jatin.singh@outlook.com. That is my Azure account, right? My Azure account is so-and-so. This is my Azure account. So what can I do? I can go to portal. .azure.com and I can sign in with this account, right? I can go to portal.azure.com and I can sign in with this account. Let me show that sign in to you as well. So what can I do? I can go to portal.azure.com. This is a website, portal.azure.com, and I can sign in with the account. Now, some people may ask, maybe someone do not have an Azure account. How can we create the Azure account? Again, if someone do not have an Azure account, you guys can go to portal.azure.com. And from there, you can create the Azure account too. You can create the Azure account too. How? Let me just sign out. I'll show it to you from the very scratch level. So guys, normally in day one and day two, we just try to build a base and then we go ahead with the more in-depth discussions. So if I would like to create an Azure account, we can go here. So maybe I do not have an Azure account. It simply gives us an option to create one from here. I can just simply click on here, create one. And it will give me an option to sign in with my account. Maybe let's say I have a Gmail account and I would like to use that Gmail account as my Azure account. I can do that. Maybe let's say I have an account jatin.singh@gmail.com. And I would like to use this account as my Azure account. I can do that. Maybe I'm trying to create an Azure account and I do not have any account as of now. Simple. I can use this, get a new email address. I can simply click on here. I can just type the email address which I'm looking for. Maybe I would like to create my email with this account, right? So I can simply use the email address that I'm looking for and I can create my Azure account like this. Possible. Now, assuming I have got my Azure account or I have created my Azure account, I would like to log in now. So how can I log in now? I'll simply go here. I will simply enter the account that I have got. So let's say this is my account. I'll simply enter my credentials. I'll enter the password for the same, and I would be able to jump inside my Azure account. So first thing we need is an Azure account, right? But in this course, we are not going to talk about the Azure portal and resources that we are going to create from Azure, no. So once you already have an Azure account, then what happens is after we have an Azure account, we have a subscription. We have a subscription in Azure accounts. We have a subscription in Azure accounts. So basically this subscription is like the billing boundary. It can be used for two boundaries, billing boundary and access boundaries. So right now we are only talking about the billing boundary. Billing boundary means just because you have created the Azure account doesn't mean that you would be able to create the resources. Resources means virtual machine, storage account, network, load balancer, anything that we are trying to create, web application. These are nothing but the resources. So if I have to create resources, I need something called as subscription. Without having a subscription, I would not be able to create the Azure account, right? Without having a subscription, I would not be able to create an Azure account. I'm giving you a very basic glimpse of Azure, because once we will be going to Azure DevOps, we will be needing these basic concepts, right? Because when we are creating something in Azure DevOps, where we will be built, we will be built to the same subscription. So we need to have a subscription. We need to have a subscription. If I am creating any task or if I am creating any work item in Azure DevOps, to whom I will assign that task? Normally in the organizations, you would have seen that a task gets created and we assign those tasks to the users, or maybe a project manager will be assigning those tasks to the DevOps engineer. So how the project manager will assign the task to the DevOps engineer? Those DevOps engineers are nothing but the users. From where those users are coming? Those users are coming from the Azure AD. Some people also call it as Azure Active Directory. Some people also call it as AAD. Same thing, right? So if I have created some task or some work items or whatever you would like to call it, or maybe I'm working on a bug, or maybe I'm working on some kind of an epic, and I would like to assign this to some user. So from where those users are coming? So those users will be coming from the Azure Active Directory. Now question comes, I have just created an Azure account. How will I get Azure Active Directory? I have just now created an Azure account. How will I get the Azure Active Directory? What happens is, let's say you create the Azure account, right? You will by default get two things. My Azure account is so-and-so. This is my Azure account. As soon as I create the Azure account, by default, I get two things. By default, we get a domain, and by default, we get a something called as default directory. So what is the domain that I will get? Whatever you have in the Azure account, it will simply remove the special characters. What are the special characters? Dot is a special character, at is a special character, and again, dot is a special character. It will remove the special characters. It will make it like this. Jitin, dot will be removed, sync. At will be removed, outlook.onmicrosoft.com. It will give you a domain like this. And if you just remove .onmicrosoft.com from here, this will be your directory. This will be your directory, first directory, default directory. Now question may come into the mind, why we are getting a domain, why we are getting a directory. In on-premise, there is something called as Windows Server Active Directory. We use that Windows Server Active Directory and then we create users based upon the same. Here, we do not have something called as Windows Server Active Directory. We have something called as Azure AD, which we will be using in order to create the users. And when we will be going to the DevOps organization, when we'll be creating the DevOps organization, and then we'll be working on a project inside our DevOps organization, we will be assigning those tasks or those work item to our users. So from where those users will be coming? Those users will be coming from our Azure Active Directory. Those users will be coming from our Azure Active Directory. We all know in order to create a user, what we need a username and a domain name. In order to create a user, what we need username and domain name. So if I have to create a user with the name test, it will become like this, test at so-and-so. If I have to create a user with the name, let's say Nitin, it will become so and so. If we have to create a user with the name, let's say Ramesh, I'm just using a generic name, guys, not pointing anyone's name here. So we can create a user like this, right? In order to create a user in cloud in Azure, what do we need? We need something called as Azure AD. Now we know that how can we get Azure AD in background, right? Now someone may ask, maybe I would like to use my own domain. Maybe I have a domain, let's say scl.com, and I want to create a user with the name test at scl.com, or maybe let's say earth at scl.com. Maybe I would like to use this. Possible. You can go to your Azure Active Directory. You can go to your Azure Active Directory. There is something called as custom domain names. You can add a custom domain names. Then you can add a custom domain name. You can add the hcl.com domain there. Once the hcl.com domain will be added, then you can create users at your domain name. Possible. Now someone may ask, I would like to assign these tasks maybe to my Windows Server users. The servers that I have created in Azure, sorry, the servers that we have created in on-premise. That is also possible. There is something called as Azure AD Connect tool. Now with the help of this tool, we can sync the on-premise users from on-premise to cloud. Now what is cloud? In cloud, we have something called as Azure AD, Azure Active Directory. So basically with the help of this tool, with the help of Azure AD Connect tool, we can bring the on-premise users from on-premise to cloud. Now, once they are a part of Azure AD, and now if I'm going to my DevOps organization and I'm creating a task, or if I'm creating a work item, or if a new bug I have to report, or I'm working on a new bug, and I would like to assign that task or that work item or that bug to an engineer, I can assign it to my on-premise engineer as well. So that is how we would be able to do it. So we need some kind of a mechanism from where we would be able to assign the task to our users. We would be able to assign some work items to our user. So how we would be getting it? We would be getting it either from the Azure AD. If in case we would like to make use of our on-premise users, we have to first bring our on-premise users, or we have to first sync our on-premise users from on-prem to cloud, and then we would be able to assign the task and everything to them. That is how we would be able to make it work. Any questions, guys, so far what we have discussed? And would request
One question from Ganesh. Yeah, so now that we will be able to create the subscription and then create the resources depend on the forming of the servers and resources, everything. Okay, so that being created, so what is the guarantee that portal will not corrupt? That is one thing. And where the all this resource information will be stored in the portal?
Okay, so you're saying portal will not corrupt means, I think I'm unable to get that. Portal will not corrupt means?
Portal means the portal.azure.com, right? So without that, you will not able to locate your created resources, right?
No, that is not correct. Let me just add some portion here. Let's say for some reason, you are unable to access your portal.com to portal.azure.com, and you say, maybe portal.azure.com is not accessible and I still would like to access my users. Access the users, or maybe access the resources. Resources, when I say, means maybe the VMs, or maybe let's say any load balancer, or maybe let's say any storage or any database that I have created. I would like to access that. I hope that is
what you're trying to say. I understood that. So because those are created, well created, and then that those will be able to access. That's fine. What if the portal information corrupt?
Portal,
the first link. If you created it and you want to do some enhancements from the portal. So if portal itself, your subscription itself, something giving you some issues and you are not able to locate your resources from the portal. Working condition, you can get it from load balancer or servers and from outside, whatever accessing. That and all fine. So what if the portal corrupts? What is the guarantee that Azure gives?
So you are saying the portal.azure.com goes down?
Yeah, your part. Yeah,
Jitin, let me answer. So yeah. Is backend, this infrastructure, so you should not worry about. That is managed by the Microsoft, right? and they have a there is a huge number of backend infrastructure where they given you will not interruption the portal.
But no, but customer need to satisfy, right?
But this is a backend infrastructure. This is like, you know, the physical infrastructure. There is a hostage in those portals, right?
I think you're not getting. So what I'm saying is, see, the hostage and farming, and that's fine. They are there. But what if...
So, sir, there are multiple... Okay, let's say for some reason, portal.azure.com, you're unable to access. There are multiple ways by which we can access the subscription and we can access the resources. Portal.azure.com is one way. We can also...
Yeah, I know that command line also you can access, but...
So you are saying for some given reason we are unable to access it from anything.
Yeah, both ways. Yes.
Then it is managed by Microsoft. There is a certain SLA that Microsoft guarantees you. So I'm just giving you an example. Do not quote the figures here. Let's say Microsoft gives you a guarantee that during the year, portal.azure.com or the services for the Azure will be up for 99.99% of the time. Means maybe during the year, you can only expect that maybe for 8 to 10 minutes or maybe let's say for 50 minutes during the year, this will go down. So this is the SLA which Microsoft will be guaranteeing you, right? So for this amount of time, the portal.azure.com, be it via browser, be it via PowerShell, be it via CLI, you would be able to access the resources or you would be able to access the portal, the Azure portal. Right. So this is the SLA that Microsoft is giving. So you can go to Microsoft website where all the SLAs are mentioned and you would be able to find that SLA. Now, let's say the question may come for some given reason, Microsoft is unable to meet the SLA. I think that could be the next question. For some given reason, Microsoft is unable to meet the SLA that they have designed. Although it has not happened so far, but it can definitely happen. There can be a possibility.
It's human curated,
it can
right?
happen. That's what my question is. Yeah, it can happen. Yeah. So in that case, if Microsoft is unable to meet the SLA what they have defined, and as a result of that, maybe you are unable to meet the SLA that you promised to your customers, then you can have an agreement with Microsoft. So if in case they would not be able to meet this SLA, probably you would be able to penalize Microsoft for the same. Or Microsoft will not be charging you the services that you have created in your subscription. Right. So either way, they will be giving you some kind of a relief. It can depend upon an agreement to agreement. If there is a very big organization, they have a huge dependency on this, then probably they would like to go in agreement with Microsoft. What will happen if in case the SLA that you are promising me, you would not be able to meet that SLA? Then terms and conditions can be negotiated. And as per that, the decisions can be taken or the penalty or whatever you have decided can be taken forward. I hope that answers your query.
So why I'm asking is actually the portal.azure.com itself, somebody can hack it. So not about the down, the beneath, whatever the resources created for the customer, that leave it that part. So portal.azure.com itself, somebody can hack it and then do some malpractices. So what is the hardening that they did for this particular portal?
So and, even Microsoft... How do we ensure
that the customer
subscription is... Right. So how your data is secure, there are websites for the Microsoft. So before Microsoft says that customer data will be secure, even Microsoft has to go for many certifications, many audits will be done in Microsoft as well. In the Microsoft Azure, it will be done. Third parties will be doing the audit. And then they will be giving those attestations to Microsoft that yes, that customer's data will be secure here. So many kind of attestations and certifications Microsoft will be getting to. For example, CJIS. Now someone may say, maybe I have stored my customer data there. What is the guarantee that Microsoft will not be sharing that data with anyone else? There is something called a CJIS. This is the standard. This is the benchmark that Microsoft is following. And they have received the certification and the attestation for the same. As per the CJIS rule, this is the US government rule, that if anyone has given any information to any government, maybe any kind of a robbery happened or any kind of a crime happened, and let's say person A has submitted some information to the government agency, then as per this protocol or as per this standard, government is not supposed to share that information with anyone else, be it any circumstances. So the identity of the person will be disclosed. So even Microsoft has to follow. Microsoft is following this particular this particular compliance, you can say, in their Azure regions, in their Azure data centers. Similarly, I'm sure you guys would have heard about ISO. Multiple ISOs, Microsoft Azure data centers, are also ISO compliant. There is something called as NIST. There is something called as HIPAA. There is something called as GDPR, right? I'm sure you guys would have heard about these compliances. So Microsoft is following these compliances, and they have achieved the attestations and the certifications for all those as well. Even Microsoft publishes these reports as well. So there are websites from, if you want, I can give you those specific websites as well. You can refer to those specific websites and you would be able to find that information. Let me show you one slide. Probably it will make things very, very clear for you. This slide is not a part of this course because this question doesn't belong to this course. Like
Jitin, so I have came again on question. So you are here and going to this testing. Okay. So I have stored data. Okay. But since Microsoft guys, they have access everywhere, maybe, right? I don't know. But what is guarantee they will not see the my data?
That's what I'm saying, sir. So Microsoft is going, following these compliances. So they have completely mentioned, like they have a Microsoft privacy statement. Let me show you something. Probably it will make more things clear. Just give me one moment, sir. I'll just come to that. I'll come to your question and to the other gentleman question too. Just allow me one moment here. Okay, I'll just take you to a couple of slides here. So first of all, there is something, let me share my screen first. Right, so there is something called as SLA, service level agreements. SLA document the specific terms that define Azure performance. So the SLA part which you're talking about, SLAs has been mentioned for each and every service. For virtual machines, for storage, for database load balancers, for every service SLAs is mentioned. If you want, you can check the SLA from here, from this website, https://azure.microsoft.com/en/us/support/legal/SLA/summary. So from here, you would be able to check the SLAs for each and every services.
Does that cover Azure portal? Or only, I believe that SLA is for the resources, right?
Everything for the portal as well, there will be an SLA, right?
Okay.
So that talks about the SLA. Now it also talks about what if Microsoft would not be able to meet the SLA. Let me show you that statement as well. Okay, before we come to that, let me show you. So service lifecycle. Okay, I think it's a part of different one. Just give me a moment. Let me open a different module together. So it's a very basic course, 900, and in that course it talks about the same. So multiple different things are mentioned in different courses. So if I take you here, okay, so here they have mentioned everything. So it says Microsoft compliance terms, and Microsoft provides the most comprehensive set of compliance offering, including certification and attestation of any cloud service provider. So these are the things which Microsoft would be able to provide you. It says you can view all Microsoft compliance offerings at Microsoft Compliance Center. This is a website where you would be able to check all these parts, the one which we were discussing, criminal justice information services. Plus, there is something called as Microsoft Privacy Statement. It says Microsoft provides the openness and honesty about how Microsoft handles the user data collected from its products and services. Microsoft Privacy Statement explains which data Microsoft processes, how Microsoft processes it, and for what purpose they process it. So if you go to microsoft.com/privacy-statement, you would be able to find each and every minute detail about how your data is secured. Then if I go here, there is something called as Microsoft.com Trust Center. It says learn about security, privacy, compliance, policies, features, and practices across Microsoft cloud products. So what security feature, what privacy feature, what compliance feature, which policies, what features Microsoft is following for its own cloud products, right? It says Trust Center website provides in-depth expert information, curated list of recommended resources arranged by topic. For every topic, there is information. Role-specific information for business managers, administrator, engineers, risk assessors, privacy officers, legal teams, and more. So for all of these categories, they have put the information. Role-specific information can be there. Maybe there is a person in the organization who is working as a risk assessor. His job is only to assess the risk. If we are putting data into Microsoft data center, how data is secured or not? So for that particular role as well, they have defined the information. Sir, I hope that answers your query to a certain extent.
Sorry to interrupt you, Jatin. I have one question.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask? Yeah, yeah, definitely, sir. Definitely.
This is not related with this training. While we are talking about the privacy and all, so that's why I have asked you. See, whatever things from last 15 years, I use the Microsoft technology and all, whatever, in terms of the physical as well as virtual both. So what I notice, in portal everywhere, whether it is recent technology or previous technology, previously it was descriptive, but now it is nowhere I is able to see that. For example, if I am using that technology, or I notice somewhere the people are doing the malpractice by using the Microsoft technology and all. So where I need to report those, they use the counterfeit product of the Microsoft, where I need to report? In India, DLF Cybersecurity Office, but they are having the toll-free number customer support kinds of. They are not having the, you cannot report, no one can report piracy software uses and all.
I think I'm unable to get your query completely. So you're saying if you are using Azure and you are using some kind of a counterfeit software.
Somebody, for example, if I notice that somewhere people are using the counterfeit software.
Where? I think I'm unable to get your query. So where the people are using the counterfeit software in Azure?
I mean, मैं इसकी बात नहीं कर रहा हूँ कि Azure में ही, मान लो कोई सर्वर है, कोई ये है, कोई ऑर्गेनाइजेशन यूज करता है, तो अगर मेरे को रिपोर्ट करना हो तो कोई टॉल फ्री नंबर में तो कोई ऐसा कस्टमर सपोर्ट के लिए होता है कि हाँ हमारा वैलिडेशन खत्म हो गया या कुछ प्रॉब्लम हो गया, मशीन री इंस्टॉल किया, तो दे दोज पीपल आर एबल टू हेल्प मी इन दोज सिनेरियो. बट मैंने ऐसा कहीं नहीं देखा कि कहीं भी ऐसा कोई माइक्रोसॉफ्ट अपने इसमें कि ये हमारा सर्विसेज है और ये हमारा नंबर है, यहाँ आप पायरेसी को रिपोर्ट कर सकते हैं.
सो बेसिकली यू आर सेइंग मे बी यू नो सम ऑर्गेनाइजेशन हु आर यूजिंग पायरेटेड सॉफ्टवेयर एंड यू वुड लाइक टू रिपोर्ट दैट टू माइक्रोसॉफ्ट, राइट?
यस.
सो ओके, सो दिस इज द लिंक व्हिच दे हैव गिवन, आई थिंक काउंटरफिट सॉफ्टवेयर रिपोर्ट. So maybe you can follow this link and you would be able to report the same, sir, right? So I think there is step-by-step instruction as mentioned here. I think this is maybe what pirated software they are using. They are using Windows Server as pirated, which version of Windows servers. So you can mention there, you can click on continue. Probably you can just follow this link. You can fill in the information. Microsoft will receive the information. And as and when they feel...
What is that? Just let me.
Yeah, I've shared the link into the chat window, sir.
Okay, fine. I will take it from there.
All right.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. One more question from me.
Yes. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So, are you going to cover the application side code pipeline as part of the DevOps or the infra side code pipeline?
When you say code pipeline, means, sir, means what in pipeline you are looking for? There are two types of pipeline. One is what we called as build pipeline. One is what we called as release pipeline. If you are looking,
both.
If any one of you are looking for any kind of a coding will be done in this course, no. There will be no coding that we will be doing. Small changes in the code we will be doing. But if anyone is looking for that we will be writing any code, no. We are not going to write any code in this particular course. If anyone has a coding experience, it is wonderful. It is definitely valuable. It will definitely add more value into his kitty. If anyone do not have any coding understanding or coding knowledge, still it is good. So in this course, we'll be talking about how we would be able to, let's say your development team has written the code. When they write the code is written into the raw format. The code is not into the executable format. So how to build that code? Code is in the raw format. We will be building the code with the help of pipeline. into such format where we would be able to deploy it, maybe into the exe format or maybe into the msi format, msi files, so that we would be able to deploy that code. We'll be talking about that. But whether we will be writing any codes for the application, we will not be writing any code for the application. But how to build the codes with the help of pipeline, how to release the code with the help of pipeline, sir, we will discuss that. We will do demonstration on that as well.
Yeah, you mean like I am from infra background, so mm-hmm. I'm already working on AWS actually. So what I'm interested in is the code infrastructure as a code, right? That's where I'm interested. So like, you know, there are a lot of applications in the organization, right? So those changes will be there, like agent upgrades, whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that part I want to be like automation, like follow from the CI/CD. And then do the builds and all. So not from the application side. So does that cover?
Absolutely. Absolutely. That will be covered.
Yeah. Got it.
So Jatin, so my advice today, so I think you should not take a class. So this kind of question, if you take, you know, other people's are lots of, you know, have a query, this kind of, so that will be the better way.
Tomorrow let me, if you start. Let me share my experience.
That kind of, because of, you know, so even I feel as some kind of more question. So let's put an everyone question today. That will be appropriate.
Right. And so let me share my experience. Correct. Thank you for guiding me. But let me share some experience. Yeah. What happens is, in day one class, the kind of a methodology we are following is, in day one class, we allow everyone that, okay, everyone can come. Everyone can have their queries. We try to answer as many queries as possible. To whatever level we can answer, we can try to answer those queries. After that, what happens is enrollment process starts. So whatever number of participants we have in day one class, during the enrollment process, many participants gets filtered out, right? Many participants, because of any reason, it could be any reason. So when we normally go into the class, we have a very healthy discussions. Right. I think there are some people who have attended some sessions previously as well on a different technology, maybe on administration, maybe on architect, or maybe on a different course altogether. So they already know. So in day one class, you may experience some turbulence. So there will be a lot of questions from here and there. They can be related. They may not be related. So maybe they are trying to get the answers for those questions. Absolutely fine. It happens. So this is what I'm talking from my experience. So I have delivered so many batches from that experience. I'm just giving this information. So what happens is, once the enrollment process starts, many people get filtered out because of any XYZ reason. Maybe they do not have a time. Maybe schedule do not match. Maybe they are looking for something else. Maybe they are looking for some different course, any XYZ reason. So when we actually go into the classes, probably from tomorrow or maybe from next week, or only the enrolled guys will be going there, right? Enrolled people will be going there. Then you'll be expecting lot of questions which are only related to this particular course, except for one or two which can anytime be there. So that is what I have seen so far with my experience.
I think this kind of questions are very much needed for the students to join the respective courses, right? Before joining, they need to know, right?
Absolutely. Any other query, guys? Any other query for today before I just take this session forward? I'll show you some more part. Okay.
One query is that initially they told that $100 something will be given, right? Discount for the Azure registration. Is something, are you aware of that?
There is something called as Azure Pass. With the help of that Azure Pass, you can create the resources into the Azure. That is the Azure Pass, which you can get. So for that, you can check with Amit. He is the right guy who would be able to update you. So yes, Azure Pass can be given, but I think for that, you can have a word with Amit. He is the guy, best guy who would be able to help you with the enrollment process and who would be able to help you with all these queries.
Thank you. Right.
Any other query team for this? Okay.
Sir, we have to pay some money for the course charge?
Definitely, sir. Definitely there will be some money for this course. Definitely there is an enrollment process which you can follow. For that, I think Amit is the right guy who would be able to help you out with the enrollment process. So absolutely, there will be some course fee. So for that, you can get in touch with Amit. He is the best guy who would be able to help.
Okay.
So
may I know who do you provide certificates after the course?
Are you saying the training attendance certificates that will be provided, sir?
Both that said,
So training attending certificates will be given, right? But if you're, if in case you are looking for DevOps certificate, for that you have to appear for the certification. You have to get a voucher, then you have to appear for the certification, and then you would be able to get the same. I hope that answers your query.
I have one question.
Yes, please go ahead, sir.
Yeah, like DevOps is a generic kind of thing. I have seen like DevOps, Azure DevOps, AWS DevOps.
Mm-hmm.
So can you just help us to understand what the difference between that?
Between the Azure DevOps, sir, I am not trained on the AWS DevOps, so would not be able to share any light on the AWS DevOps, right? Azure DevOps, as I mentioned, it is a practice that the organizations and multiple teams collaboratively follow. It is a union of people, process, and infrastructure and technology all together, so that basically we would be able to give a better user experience to the client. Basically, how fast and how effectively we can build the product, it will talk about that. So it's a one-line thing, but here there will be multiple tools that we will be using. We will be using something called as Azure Repos. We will be using something called as Kanban Boards. Let me show you. So what happens is, when we go to dev.azure.com, inside dev.azure.com, you create your project. That the project, actually you are working on an AnyLive environment, so, right? You will be creating a project. On that project, you will have multiple things. On that project, first of all, you will have a repository where the code is being stored. For that, we have something called as Azure Repos. Then there will be pipelines of multiple types, build pipeline, release pipeline. Then you will be integrating your IDE, the tools where the developer works, where they build the codes. You will be integrating those tools with this particular project. You will be integrating your Azure Active Directory to whom you will be assigning tasks. Then there are different kind of a project, brownfield or greenfield kind of a project. So you create the projects. Then there is something called as branches. There is something called as Kanban boards, which mostly project managers or management level people use in order to see the progress or in order to track the progress of a particular project, right? Then there is something called as artifacts. When a developer writes the code is into the raw format. So from a raw format, you convert the code into an executable format, and then you store that executable code somewhere. Maybe we can store that into the artifacts. So multiple things are there. So those tools, these are some basic tools that I have given. Now these tools have a very in-depth understanding. So we'll talk about all that part in this. Sir, I hope I have given you a glimpse like what the course will talk about, how it is helping an organization.
So basically AWS and Azure, or be it Google, anything, the DevOps follows.
If I attend this session, can I attend for an interview which is in AWS DevOps? That is my question.
Sir, if you are attending the DevOps, Azure DevOps, I think there are a lot of jobs nowadays into the Azure DevOps. Why do you want to appear for the AWS DevOps then? Lot of job openings are there.
Different, because I am a certified Azure administrator.
So the certified Azure administrator, and you will be attending the Azure DevOps. Then I think the market for you will be very good, right? Then why do you want to go with AWS? I think I was unable to get that part.
Very good, but I want to grow up like an architect. Yeah, I just want to go to be architect position to have an knowledge in AWS and GCP.
Okay. Then so I
terminology
think,
will be different, or concept?
Concept is same. So it says, what is the difference? AWS DevOps is a set of developer tools that allows the users to create CI/CD pipeline from source to the deployment stage.
Okay.
Azure DevOps is a tool provided by Microsoft that allows us to implement DevOps lifecycle and business. So I think the horizon of the Azure DevOps is much, much greater than the AWS. AWS DevOps is nothing but a set of developers tool that you can use in order to do CI/CD. Azure DevOps is a tool provided by Microsoft, dedicated tool that allows us to implement a DevOps life cycle in business. Right. So,
okay.
Manage access to features by accessing. Yeah. But my recommendation to you would be, if you are Azure administrator, you'll be DevOps, and then you want to become the architect. I think architect level is entirely different as compared to DevOps. These are two different levels, I would say. Architect is also a professional level, like not a beginner level, not an intermediate level. It's a high level. Same is the case with DevOps. But nowadays, DevOps demand is increasing, and the packages, mostly everyone is out for the money as well into the market. The kind of a packages that has been offered to the DevOps, they are much greater than as compared to what is being offered to the Azure architects. That is the understanding that I have seen in the market. And if you want to grow your career in both the clouds, then you should learn AWS too. Then probably you will be connect like a multi-cloud engineer or a multi-cloud architect, something like that. Right. Sir, I hope that answers your query.
Sir, I have a small doubt. I'm Dilip. I'm currently working as the on-premises engineer, like a system administrator. Mm-hmm. Can I go for Azure DevOps? Means, can my understanding level, I can able to get this Azure DevOps?
Definitely, sir. Definitely, you will be able to go with that. There can be some hiccups. If you would be able to cover it up, then definitely you can go with that. So if you have a bit of understanding of Azure AD, or if not, then probably I would be able to share you one or two videos for Azure AD. Then you would be able to take it up from there.
Right? Is there any use of PowerShell here, sir? We have to use any script in the Azure DevOps, or only in the GUI?
If you have knowledge of PowerShell, that is always beneficial. If you do not have, still you would be able to manage your work. But whenever you are working as a DevOps engineer, recommendation is slowly and gradually we should develop using some kind of a scripting methods. That is a recommendation, right?
Yeah, sir. One more thing, sir. As you said before in the session, actually, unfortunately, my internet issue, I got disconnected.
Mm-hmm.
As you said, from the Azure AD, we can assign tasks. How could it be possible? Means as I said, on-premises engineer. So I have done a hybrid AD. If you are talking about Azure AD and Sync AD, those tools, like we can do is hybrid AD too.
Yeah, Azure AD can do. See, right now I'm into my DevOps organization. This is my Azure portal, right? So here in my Azure portal, I will have something called as Azure Active Directory, where I can create some set of users here. Now I am going to my DevOps. Right? Maybe I can go to my organization settings. Maybe I can connect my Azure Active Directory with my DevOps organization. Here also I'm getting Azure Active Directory.
Yes.
If I go to my Azure Active Directory here, maybe the directory that I have in my Azure portal, I can connect my directory here. Maybe I can click on connect directory. Which directory? Same as the account here, v-2gis@outlook.com. Same is the account here, v-2gis@outlook.com. So I am getting an option to integrate my Active Directory here, or Azure Active Directory here, basically. Right? I hope you're able to see it, sir. So what I would be able to do, maybe I would be able to integrate my directory. Which directory? Maybe I'm using default directory. So I hope you're able to see the tenant ID, B39CEF59. If I go here, there is something called as default directory, same directory. If I go here, same tenant ID, B39CEF59. So what I will be doing, I will be first integrating my Azure AD with my DevOps. Then the users that I have in Azure AD, I would be able to see those users here. Once I would be able to see those users here, now do you feel we would be able to assign some tasks to the Azure AD users here?
Yeah, we can do it by the Microsoft plan too.
Absolutely.
We can do.
Right. And now, as you already know that we can bring the users from on-prem to cloud with the help of some kind of a sync method, Azure AD Connect tool. And while syncing it, we can have some kind of an authentication method, maybe password hash, PTA, maybe federation with ADFS. Now, do you feel that we can assign on-premise users some task here? Absolutely. So that is how we can do it. How exactly we do it? We will talk about every session. There will be some practicals. There will be some labs. There will be some theoretical discussions. Slowly and gradually, we will build the base.
Yes, sir. And also last question, sir, from my end. Is the DevOps engineer need to assign the task? That is the daily job duties, what you're saying.
DevOps engineer normally get the task and they can even assign the task. So it can entirely depend upon the organization that you're working upon. So in smaller organization, maybe DevOps engineer is the one who is managing everything. In a bigger organization, maybe they have some compliance kind of an issue that only project managers will be assigning the task and they will be assigning it to DevOps engineer. It can vary from organization to organization. It entirely depends upon the rights, how much rights you are giving to which particular user. If you have given the rights to the DevOps engineer that it can even go ahead and assign the task, it can do that. But for some reason, because of some kind of a policy, some kind of a compliance, if we have not given the rights to the DevOps engineer, DevOps engineer will be an identity in my Azure AD. So if I have not given that permissions and that task to the DevOps engineer, do you feel that person would be able to assign the task? In that case, no. So it can vary from organization to organization. I hope that answers your query, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay.
What is the cost of this course? Someone has a query. Amit is the right guy who would be able to assist you with that particular query. So he's the one from the management team who will be able to help you out with the enrollment process.
Sorry, my mobile was disconnected. Meantime, yeah. What was the duration of the course? How many sessions? Day? Many days sessions?
So the official content of the course is around 40 hours, but that 40 hours. So let me give you some idea. So what happens is in corporate batches, what is? Let me show you here. Let me give you the idea. Although the intent is not to cover the course or to give you only dedicated number of hours. So the official content of the course is for 40 hours. So when we deliver the corporate batches, I'm sure you guys are aware of the corporate batches. It is delivered 5 days a week and every day it is delivered for 8 hours. So during that 8 hours, 1 hour is dedicated to the participants at the end of the session that they will be spending that time for the labs. Approximately around close to 1.5 hours is for the break time, right? Continuously, we cannot go for it. So if you see it here, out of 8 hours, we spend close to like 5.5 hours. So if you multiply that 5.5 hours by 5 or by 6, whatever you do it, it will come out somewhere around 30 hours of technical discussions in labs, right? But I am just giving you a glimpse how the course is designed by Microsoft. But here we will be going either for between 5 to 6 weeks, it will take, and every week we will be spending like 4 hours. During that 4 hours, it will be only me who will be presenting something. Definitely we will have questions and the answers round. I will be showing you demonstrations. And whatever I'll show you as a demonstration on Saturday and Sunday, you will be getting 5 days from Monday to Friday. You can perform those labs on your own machines, on your own environment, on your own test labs, whatever you would like to do it. So that 1 hour of dedicated time, which we normally give to the participants during a batch time, we would not be giving you that, right? In order to save your time as well as our time, there will be no break during the 2 hour session, right? So we would be able to accommodate that time. And within 5 to 6 weeks, we would be able to cover up the content. If in case it needs more time, we will be spending more time. So as long as we are having a, we would be able to deliver a, we, the intent is basically to do a lot of knowledge sharing with the help of this course, right? So that is the entire intent. Sir, I hope that answers your query.
Yeah, that you.
Any other questions, any other queries, guys, for me?
Yeah, I'm Amit Pramod here. So I have a different background, right? So I'm a BMR strategist engineer. Okay, I have a 15 years experience, and I have also done the Azure course and the certification done. So I'm now I'm mindset. Okay, let's be in a stick in the this IT fields. Let's move to in a cloud. So I choose in Azure. So I've already done the Azure. So and Amit knows me. So I try to move in this DevOps and tech. Let's move and go to cloud. So how much will help me to know go on cloud? So since already I've completed Azure Administrator and now I'm talking going to take an DevOps. So how much will help and my career?
So sir, just there are two things. Let me be very frank with you guys. Let me give you some information like that is normally which we do not discuss, right?